Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents In the Name of Rome, The Men Who Won the Roman Empire, by Adrian Goldsworthy. Narrated by Derek Perkins. Preface to the Yale University Press edition. It is now more than a dozen years since I wrote In the Name of Rome, although at that stage it was provisionally entitled Imperator. It is more than 20 years since I listened to lectures given by our colonel in the OTC at Oxford University. I'm pleased to say that he had no objection to being described as a properly fed Monty, but then I would never have written the words if I had thought that they might cause offence. Since then, apart from some shorter works and articles, I have written 4 long works on aspects of Roman history and will finish the 5th at the end of this year. The chapters on Julius Caesar and Pompey in this book led to much fuller treatments in Caesar, Life of a Colossus, 2006, while Julian and Belisarius featured in How Rome Fell, Death of a Superpower, 2009. I have little doubt that I will return to several of the subjects in this book, whether to look at the generals themselves, their eras, or particular parts of the empire. Each time you look at a topic, you tend to see things you have not noticed before. Occasionally, this is because new evidence has appeared. Sometimes it comes from a fresh thesis presented by a scholar, usually on a much broader issue, and even more often, something just jumps out from the sources in a way it had not done before. I have never yet read any sizable chunk of Caesar's Bellum Gallicum without seeing something new. Your focus at the time, recent reading in other accounts, and the gradual development and modification of ideas all contribute to looking at the same text in a slightly different way. This is rarely a question of the overall interpretation, and far more about detail and revealing more of the context to an action, so helping to explain it. A common question I am asked is which of my books is my favourite. The choice is getting wider, and Augustus, First Emperor of Rome, 2014, was my 10th work of non-fiction, but the answer is always the next one. It is a great joy to move on to a new aspect of ancient history and be able to immerse myself in it for 3 years or so, researching and then writing. My hope is that each new book is better than its predecessors, both as history and in its readability. Historians never stop learning, gaining wider knowledge of their own field and also of other periods and topics which may provide useful comparisons. Even more than the study of history, writing is a craft learned through practice. You learn through doing, which means that looking back at earlier efforts comes with a strong urge to rewrite them, even though this is rarely a good idea. When I came to look again at In the Name of Rome, it surprised me that there really is very little that I would wish to change. Once or twice, a bright idea proved to be something I had included in the first place and forgotten about. 12 years is a long time, and I have written getting on for 1 million words since then on various aspects of Roman history. The selection of generals still strikes me as sound. It would have been nice to have someone from the 3rd century AD, but there is not enough evidence to trace any individual's campaigns with the same level of detail as in the other chapters. Aurelian was the only one I considered, but I still feel that it is difficult to analyze his campaigns with such poor sources. Corbulo makes a good contrast to the succession of imperial princes like Germanicus and Titus or the Emperor Julian. The true talents of these last 3 are debatable, and in each case they were given command on the basis of family connection. Yet, since the other commanders in the book owed their own prominence to political success, we should be cautious before marking these down as wholly different from the others. The main aim of the book was always to trace the changing relationship between commander and state and, in the process, give an overview of the way the Roman military worked in each period, and in particular, how its high command functioned. Each man can only be understood by placing him within the context of his era and culture. Given that we start with a republic controlling no more than Italy, Sicily, and Sardinia, Corsica, follow its expansion throughout the Mediterranean and beyond, and the resulting convulsions of civil war which led to the rule of emperors, and then later the fragmentation of the empire into western and eastern halves, with the former collapsing and the latter continuing to thrive, these are vast subjects. Simply when it comes to background, each chapter could be made far longer. Tempting though it was, and is, to add more detail, and to admit that some issues are far more complicated than a summary suggests, expansion would quickly render the whole book unwieldy. Covering more than 7 centuries of Rome's history, primarily from a military perspective, inevitably means that the best that can be hoped for is to give some flavour for each period. Trying to understand these 15 men remains a far more useful exercise than judging them or ranking them against each other or commanders from other eras. There may be lessons for leaders today to learn from the ancient past, but if so, then it is vital that we must first do our best to examine that past on its own terms. I am no more inclined to write management success the Roman way now than I was earlier. This book is about trying to understand these commanders as best we can, but it is worth reminding ourselves once again that there is much we do not and cannot know about the events of so many centuries ago. In 1935, the future Field Marshal Lord Wavell, commander in the Western Desert from 1940 to 1941 and later in the Far East, wrote to the historian Little Hart, saying that the principles of strategy and tactics and the logistics of war are really absurdly simple. It is the actualities that make war so complicated and so difficult and are usually so neglected by historians. So many factors of fatigue, weather, hunger, chance, and confused information about his own side, let alone the enemy, clutter the mind of the human being who happens to be in command of an army. In our case, almost all such material is lost for the Romans, let alone their foreign adversaries, and we are forced to piece together the story from very little evidence. As a result, a book like In the Name of Rome inevitably uses a lot of guesswork to fill in the many gaps in our sources. Here, as in my other books, I have done my best to explain what evidence we have and make clear its limits. It is bad history to present conjecture as if it were fact, and yet so much of what we must say about the Roman army is conjectural. This includes not simply the details of specific campaigns and battles, but a good deal about its drills, organization, tactics, routine, equipment, and command structure. Historians can do no more than give their best guesses about so many of these things, and often our guesses are based on earlier guesses. It is useful to think in terms of what seems the most likely practical solution to a problem, and draw as widely as possible on methods used by better documented armies in other periods, an approach sometimes known as the test of inherent military probability. Yet, plausibility does not constitute proof, and my best guesses may be wrong. It is perfectly possible that the Romans did not act in the way we expect, and arrange things in a way natural to them, but at the same time alien, even unimaginable, to us. We simply do not know, and must always remember this. Military history in general remains a neglected field among academic ancient historians, so there has been less written about this theme in the last 12 years than you might expect. Most is indirect, concerned with political and social background rather than military events. Direct study of a battle or campaign remains an extremely rare, almost unheard of, theme for an academic article or monograph. One exception is for those few battlefield sites subject to archaeological survey and excavation. None of the sites discussed in detail here has yet been located and subjected to such investigation, but a couple of sites are associated with episodes touched upon in our chapters. The most detailed and best studied finds so far are those at Calcrisa, which is widely accepted as the site of one from the series of ambushes which led to the destruction of Varus' 3 legions in AD 9. In Spain, the battlefield of Baecula has been located, and preliminary reports suggest that it will reveal much interesting detail. Advances in the techniques of locating and understanding archaeological evidence from battlefields make it likely that more will be found. Even so, physical traces of battles, as opposed to sieges, require very careful interpretation, consisting mainly of fieldworks and metal items ranging from hobnails to pieces of weapons. Ancient battles inevitably lack the cartridge cases and spent rounds found at Little Bighorn and other more modern sites. Reconstructing the course of a battle from the sort of evidence we have still relies on an understanding of how armies operated, derived mainly from the literary sources. It is unlikely that such sites will tell us much, if anything, about the role of the commander. J. E. Lendon's Soldiers and Ghosts, A History of Battle in Classical Antiquity, 2006, has a good deal to say about commanders and their behavior, and so is of great relevance to our theme. Lendon focuses on the cultural influences which shaped their conduct, asking us to look at military history in a very different way from the traditional approach, and not simply impose our logic on the actions of men from very different societies. If anything, this paints Julian's actions as commander even less favorably than I have portrayed them, especially in the Eastern campaign when he and his staff emulated Scipio Africanus and Polybius at Carthage. Our reaction is dismay, but clearly at least some contemporaries considered such competition with long-dead heroes entirely valid. No single approach to understanding ancient commanders, or any other aspect of antiquity's military past, can hope to provide all the answers. We cannot reject the pragmatic approach or neglect the actualities of war. Soldiers and tribal warriors alike need to be fed, clothed, and equipped, although what is considered adequate in each of these categories may vary a great deal even among contemporary societies. Leaders must gather information, consider it, and act upon it, and they must, through some means, communicate their wishes to the men they lead and attempt to convert their intentions into action, and they cannot ignore the restrictions imposed by physical geography. Supplying, controlling, and directing large numbers of soldiers are complex tasks, where friction brings mistakes, delays, and confusions, large and small, and so creates problems even before an enemy becomes involved. Culture plays a central role in shaping the response of leaders to these problems, just as an army is the product of a society. Except in the case of civil war, culture, society, political system, and understanding of what a war is and how it should be fought are likely to vary to a greater or lesser extent between the two sides. No serious study of a general or a campaign can afford to neglect any of these factors. Yet, for all that, we cannot ignore the personality of the commander. While all of us are products of our society and culture, we are not all alike, and, just as I wrote in the Name of Rome, the character of those holding high office significantly influences their actions. Scipio Africanus, Caesar, Corbulo, and the others were human beings whose personalities mattered. My view of the importance of leaders has not changed at all. A book combining military history with aspects of biography is doubly unfashionable by academic standards, where neither approach is favored, especially by ancient historians. I do not pretend that these approaches provide all the answers or allow us to understand every aspect of events, but the same is true of any other methodology, and the neglect of such old-fashioned ways of writing history distorts our understanding of the Roman world. Leaders matter, and this book looks at some of them, and through them gives an overview of the rise and fall of the Roman Empire. If I sat down to write it now, the style might be a little different, and some factors would be emphasized a little more, but in every important aspect, In the Name of Rome would be the same. Adrian Goldsworthy, Penarth, June 2015. Preface. This is the only place that you can learn leadership. It was a theme to which the colonel frequently returned in the talks which brought to a close many of the weekly drill nights in the officer training corps at Oxford. After parade, followed by a couple of hours of lectures and training about everything from map reading, chemical warfare, first aid, and small unit tactics to how to write a letter, or later, once I had joined the RA troop, tiring but exhilarating practice in taking the light guns into and out of action, we would file into a large and luxurious auditorium loaned from the, at least according to legend, fabulously rich University Air Squadron. By this time, most were impatient to be let loose on the mess, but being both teetotal and keen on military history, I rather enjoyed these sessions. For 30 minutes or so, the colonel, looking like a properly fed Monty, would talk about the attributes of a good leader, telling stories of Marlborough, Nelson, and Slim, and, on occasions, even the more unorthodox methods of Lawrence and Wingate. Sometimes he would show us a chart or diagram depicting the skills required to lead, but the assumption was always that leaders learned not so much from reading, instruction, and theory, but from doing. This is not to say that formal instruction and training is of no value, simply that on its own it is not enough. Experience is always the best tutor, and of course any system of training is really just an attempt to impart lessons from the experience and insights of others. Leaders matter. So, in their way for good or ill, does every individual person involved in any activity or project, but those with greater power and responsibility to direct an operation inevitably have more influence on events. I am not a soldier, nor in the solitary existence of a writer am I much called upon to lead or direct anyone else, a point brought home to me while writing this book when I gave a talk on Roman styles of leadership to a group of British Army officers. 2 years in the Oxford University OTC represents the sum total of my military experience, and although I found it richly rewarding and illuminating, I doubt that it altered my essentially civilian status. It did serve as a useful reminder of how difficult it is to coordinate the movements of even a few hundred men, and helped to illustrate how much friction inevitably occurs even on exercise. The whole hurry up and wait business so familiar to all those who have ever worn uniform. Perhaps even more valuable for the present topic, it provided many illustrations of the difference made by leaders. The best were not always especially visible or even especially vocal. It was just that everything seemed to run smoothly whenever they were in charge. A university officer training corps is filled with young and inexperienced cadets and inevitably contains a very broad range of talents. A minority were natural leaders, instinctively good at motivating and directing others, while the vast majority had to learn how to do this gradually, inevitably making mistakes along the way. A tiny handful would probably never learn, and in many ways the presence of a bad leader was far more obvious than a good one. This book is about some of Rome's most successful generals and their victories. Its concern is with establishing what happened during these specific campaigns, battles, and sieges, and especially with how the commander went about his task of leading and controlling an army. Roman generals received no formal training before being appointed to high commands, and whatever they had learned up to this point, they had learned by experience or in formal conversation and study. They were also selected as much, probably more, on the basis of family background and political connections as on any estimate of their ability. In a modern sense, they were amateurs, and so by extension, unskilled and poor at their job. One of the themes of this book is to reject this assumption, for the standard of Rome's military leaders seems actually to have been good. Although the subjects of this study represent in many ways the pick of the bunch, it will become evident that these men did not act in ways significantly different to other Roman generals. The best commanders simply did the same things better than anyone else. Rome's generals were shaped by practical experience and common sense, two elements which no system of producing leaders or managers should ever neglect. History concerns the actions and interactions of human beings, and as such, the study of any aspect of the past tells us something about the nature of humanity, and hence helps us to understand our own times. I am sure that lessons can be learned from studying the campaigns of Roman generals, but that is not the purpose of this book. I have no desire to write something entitled Management Success the Roman Way. So many of those who seek to lay down fixed rules for effective leadership give the impression of lacking any of the attributes necessary to exercise it. Much of what a successful general does appears easy and straightforward when written coldly on a page, in the same way that any list of principles of war appears to be little more than common sense. The difficulty lies in implementing these in practice and in how the general gets things done in the field. Thousands could copy the actions and mannerisms of a Caesar or a Napoleon and fail dismally, appearing ridiculous in the process. I do not intend to spend time in the following chapters dissecting each commander's decisions on campaign, still less putting forward better alternatives of my own devising from the comfort of my office. Nor do I intend to rank the men discussed in order of ability or debate their merits and defects in comparison to famous commanders from other periods. Instead, our concern is with such things as what was actually done, why was it done, what it was supposed to achieve, how it was implemented, and what were its consequences in fact. The aim is to understand the past on its own terms, and for an historian, that is an end in itself. Once that is done, then those so inclined may usefully add the episodes described to the pool of information which helps each of us to understand how people function in the world around us. Experience, whether personal or vicarious, is of value to leader and follower alike. The hard part is using it well. I should at this point thank various family members and friends, and in particular Ian Hughes, who read and commented on the manuscript in all of its various stages. I would also like to thank Keith Lowe and the staff at Wiedenfeld and Nicholson for putting forward the idea for this book in the first place and seeing it through to publication. Introduction. From the beginning, chieftain and hero to politician and general. The duty of a general is to ride by the ranks on horseback, show himself to those in danger, praise the brave, threaten the cowardly, encourage the lazy, fill up gaps, transpose a unit if necessary, bring aid to the wearied, anticipate the crisis, the hour, and the outcome. Onosander's summary of a general's battlefield role was written in the middle of the 1st century AD, but reflected a command style which persisted for at least 700 years and was characteristically Roman. The general was there to direct the fighting and to inspire his soldiers by making them feel that they were being closely watched and that a conspicuous act of courage would be rewarded as promptly as conspicuous cowardice would be punished. It was not his job to plunge into the thick of the fray, sword or spear in hand, fighting at the head of his men and sharing their dangers. The Romans knew that Alexander the Great had led his Macedonians to victory in this way time after time, but there was never any real expectation that their own commanders should emulate such heroics. Onosander was himself a Greek, and a man without military experience, writing in a genre whose style had been set in the Hellenistic era, but for all the literary stereotypes contained within his work, the figure of the commander depicted in his The General was most decidedly Roman. The book was written in Rome and dedicated to Quintus Veranius, a Roman senator who would die while in command of the army in Britain in AD 58. The Romans proudly boasted that they had copied much of their tactics and military equipment from their foreign enemies, but their debt to others was far less when it came to the basic structure of their army and the functions performed by its leaders. This is a book about generals, and specifically about 15 of the most successful Roman commanders from the late 3rd century BC to the middle of the 6th century AD. Some of these men are still relatively well known, at least amongst military historians. Scipio Africanus, Pompey, and Caesar would all certainly be considered for inclusion amongst the ranks of the ablest commanders in history, while others have been largely forgotten. All, with the possible exception of Julian, were at the very least competent generals who won significant successes, even if they ultimately suffered defeat, but most were very talented. Selection has been based on their importance, both in the wider history of Rome and in the development of Roman warfare, and also on the availability of sufficient sources to describe them in any detail. There is only a single subject from each of the 2nd, 4th, and 6th centuries AD, and none from the 3rd or 5th centuries, simply because the evidence for these periods is so poor. For the same reason, we cannot discuss in detail the campaigns of any Roman commander before the Second Punic War. Yet the spread remains wide, and the individual subjects illustrate well the changes both in the nature of the Roman army and in the relationship between a general in the field and the state. Rather than survey a man's entire career, each chapter focuses on one or two specific episodes during his campaigns, looking in some detail at how each man interacted with and controlled his army. The main emphasis is always on what the commander did at each stage of an operation, and how far this contributed to its outcome. Such an approach, with elements of biography and a concentration on the general's role, on strategy, tactics and their implementation, and on leadership, represents a very traditional style of military history. Inevitably, it involves a strong element of narrative and descriptions of the more dramatic elements of wars, of battles and sieges, trumpets and swords. Though popular with a general listener, this sort of history has in recent decades lacked academic respectability. Instead, scholars have preferred to look at the broader picture, hoping to perceive deeper economic, social, or cultural factors which were held to have a more important influence on the outcome of conflicts than individual decisions or events during a war. To make the topic even less fashionable, this is also essentially a book about aristocrats, since the Romans felt that only the high-born and privileged deserved to be entrusted with high command. Even a new man, novus homo, such as Marius, derided for his vulgar origins by the inner elite of the Senate, even as he forced his way in to join them, still came only from the margins of the aristocracy and was not in any real sense more representative of the wider population. By modern standards, all Roman commanders were also essentially amateur soldiers. Most spent only part of their career, usually well under half of their adult lives, serving with the army. None received any formal training for command, and they were appointed on the basis of political success, which in turn was reliant to a great extent on birth and wealth. Even a man like Belisarius, who did serve as an officer for most of his life, was promoted because of his perceived loyalty to the Emperor Justinian, and did not pass through any organized system of training and selection. At no time in Rome's history was there ever anything even vaguely resembling a staff college to educate commanders and their senior subordinates. Works of military theory were common in some periods, but many were little more than drill manuals, often describing the maneuvers of Hellenistic phalanxes whose tactics had been obsolete for centuries, and all lacked detail. Some Roman generals are supposed to have prepared themselves for high command purely through reading such works, although this was never considered to be the best way to learn. Roman aristocrats were supposed to learn how to lead an army just as they learned how to behave in political life by watching others and through personal experience in junior capacities. To modernize, the selection of generals on the basis of their political influence, under the assumption that they would know enough to be able to pick up the job of a commander as they went along, seems absurdly random and inefficient. It has often been assumed that Roman generals were usually men of extremely limited talents. In the 20th century, Major General J.F.C. Fuller characterized Roman generals as little more than drill masters, whilst W. Messer declared that they achieved a fairly consistent level of mediocrity. Perhaps at this point we should also remember Moltke's comment that, in war with its enormous friction, even the mediocre is quite an achievement. The undeniable success of the Roman army for so many centuries is often held to have been achieved in spite of its generals rather than because of them. To many commentators, the tactical system of the legions seems designed to take responsibility away from the army commander and instead place much of it in the hands of more junior officers. The most important of these were the centurions, who are seen as highly professional and therefore good at their jobs. Occasionally, there appeared men like Scipio or Caesar, who were far more talented than the typical aristocratic general, but their skill was largely a reflection of instinctive genius and could not be emulated by others. The subject of this book could be seen as such aberrations, the tiny minority of genuinely skillful commanders produced by the Roman system, along with the vast majority of non-entities and downright incompetence. In much the same way, the 18th and early 19th century British Army's system of purchase and patronage produced the occasional Wellington or Moore amongst such dismal leaders as Whitelock, Elphinstone, and Raglan. Yet a closer examination of the evidence suggests that most of these assumptions are at best greatly exaggerated, and often simply wrong. Far from taking power away from the general, the Roman tactical system concentrated it in his hands. Junior officers such as centurions played a vitally important role, but they fitted into a hierarchy with the army commander at the top and allowed him to have more control of events rather than less. Some commanders were certainly better at their job than others, but the activities of a Scipio, Marius, or Caesar on campaign do not appear to have been profoundly different from their contemporaries. The best Roman generals led and controlled their armies in essentially the same way as any other aristocrat, and the difference lay primarily in the skill with which they did so. In most periods, the standard of the average Roman commander was actually quite good for all their lack of formal training. Over the centuries, the Romans produced their share of incompetents who led the legions to needless disasters, but this has been true of all armies throughout history. It is extremely unlikely that even the most sophisticated modern methods of selecting and preparing officers for high rank will not occasionally throw up an individual who will prove to be utterly unsuited to high command. Others may appear to have every attribute necessary for a successful general, but will fail largely because of factors seemingly beyond their control. Many victorious Roman generals openly boasted that they were lucky, acknowledging that, as Caesar was to write, fortune played even more of a central role in warfare than in other human activities. Studying the conduct of warfare and the role of the commander may not be fashionable, but that does not mean that it is unimportant or unprofitable. War played a major part in Rome's history, for military success created and for a long time preserved the empire. Wider factors, attitudes to warfare and Rome's capacity and willingness to devote enormous human and material resources to waging war, underlay the effectiveness of the Roman military, but did not make its success inevitable. In the Second Punic War, such factors allowed the Republic to endure the series of staggering disasters inflicted on it by Hannibal, but the war could not be won until a way was found to defeat the enemy on the battlefield. The events of a campaign, and especially the battles and sieges, were obviously influenced by the wider context, but were still, as the Romans knew, intensely unpredictable. In any battle, and most of all a battle fought primarily with edged weapons, the outcome was never wholly certain and was determined by many factors, morale chief amongst them. Unless the Roman army could defeat its opponent in the field, wars could not be won. Understanding how they did or did not do this is never simply a matter of such apparent certainties as resources, ideology, and even equipment and tactics, for it requires a wider appreciation of the behavior of human beings, both as individuals and groups. All history, including military history, is ultimately about people, their attitudes, emotions, actions, and interactions with each other, and this is best achieved by establishing what actually happened before proceeding to explain why it did so. Too heavy a concentration on wider factors can obscure this as easily as the old-fashioned depiction of battles as being fought by symbols on a map, where victory goes to the side most purely applying tactics based upon fixed principles of war. The most imaginative tactics were of little value if a commander was unable to get his army, consisting of thousands or maybe tens of thousands of individual soldiers, into the right places at the right time to implement them. The practical business of controlling, maneuvering, and supplying an army occupied far more of a commander's time than the devising of clever strategy or tactics. More than any other single individual, the actions of the general influenced the course of a campaign or battle. For good or ill, what the commander did or did not do mattered. Sources. By far the greatest part of our evidence for the careers of Roman generals is derived from the Greek and Latin literary accounts of their actions. At times we are able to supplement this with sculptural or other artistic depictions of commanders, with inscriptions recording achievements, and on rare occasions with excavated traces of the operations of their armies, such as the remains of siege works. Valuable though such things are, it is only in the written accounts that we are told about what generals actually did and how their armies operated. As we have already noted, the selection of the subjects for the following chapters has owed much to the survival of adequate descriptions of their campaigns. Only a tiny fraction of the works written in antiquity have survived. Many other books are known only by name, or from fragments so minute as to be of little value. We are extremely fortunate to have Julius Caesar's own commentaries describing his campaigns in Gaul and the Civil War. Obviously, such an account is highly favourable to its author, but the wealth of detail it supplies concerning his activities provides an invaluable picture of a general in the field. Significantly, it also highlights those attributes and achievements believed by an audience of contemporary Romans to be most admirable in an army commander. Many, perhaps most, other Roman generals also wrote their commentaries, but none of these accounts have survived in any useful form. At best, we may find traces of these lost works in the narratives of later historians who drew upon them as a source. Caesar's operations are understood primarily from his own description of them, which only occasionally is supplemented by information from other authors. The great victories of his contemporary and rival Pompey the Great are only described in any detail by authors who wrote more than a century after his death. Such a gap between the events themselves and our earliest surviving account of them is typical for a good deal of Greek and Roman history. It is all too easy to forget that our most detailed sources for Alexander the Great were written more than 400 years after his reign. Occasionally, we are more fortunate and have a work written by an eyewitness of many of the events recounted. Polybius was with Scipio Aemilianus at Carthage in 147 to 146 BC, and may possibly also have been at Numantia, although in fact his description of these operations is in the main only preserved in passages written by others. More directly, Josephus was with Titus during the siege of Jerusalem. Ammianus served under Julian the Apostate briefly in Gaul and during the Persian expedition, while Procopius accompanied Belisarius throughout his campaigns. Sometimes other authors refer to similar eyewitness accounts which have been lost, but it was not customary for ancient historians to give the sources for the information they present. In most cases, we simply have a narrative written many years after an event whose reliability is usually impossible to prove or disprove. Many ancient historians open their works with protestations of their intention to be truthful, yet it was even more important for them to produce a text that was dramatic and highly readable, for history was supposed to entertain as much as, if not more than, it informed. Sometimes personal or political bias led to conscious distortion of the truth, while on other occasions inadequate or non-existent sources were supplemented by invention, often employing traditional rhetorical themes. On other occasions, the military ignorance of the author led him to misunderstand his source, as when Livy mistranslated Polybius' description of the Macedonian phalanx lowering its pikes into the fighting position to say that they dropped their pikes and fought with their swords. This is a rare case where the texts of both the original source and a later version have survived, but only seldom do we have this luxury. For some campaigns, we have more than one source describing the same events, and so may compare their details, but more often we are reliant on a single account. If we reject its testimony, then we usually have nothing with which to replace it. Ultimately, we can do little more than assess the plausibility of each account and perhaps register varying degrees of skepticism. Politics and War, from the beginning till 218 BC. The Romans did not begin to write history until the end of the 3rd century BC, and were virtually ignored by Greek writers until around the same time. It was only following the defeat of Carthage in 201 BC that histories of Rome began to be set down. For times before living memory, there were a few formal records of law, magistrates elected in each year and the celebration of religious festivals, but virtually nothing to set flesh on these bare bones apart from folk memories, poems, and songs, most of which celebrated the deeds of the great aristocratic houses. Later, this rich oral culture would help inspire the stories Livy and other writers would tell of Rome's earliest days, of Romulus' foundation of the city and the six kings who succeeded him, till the last was expelled and Rome became a republic. There may well be many faint strands of truth interwoven with romantic invention in such tales, but it is now impossible to separate the two. Instead, we shall merely survey the traditions concerning military leadership at Rome. Traditionally founded in 753 BC, Rome was for centuries only a small community, or probably several small communities which, over time, coalesced into one. The warfare waged by the Romans in these years was on a correspondingly small scale, consisting mainly of raiding and cattle rustling, with the occasional skirmish-like battle. Most of the Romans' leaders were warrior chieftains in the heroic mould, although the stories about the wisdom and piety of King Numa suggest that other attributes were also felt to be worthy of respect. Such kings and chiefs were leaders because in time of war they fought with conspicuous courage. In many respects, they resembled the heroes of Homer's Iliad, who fought so that people would say, "Indeed, these are no ignoble men who are lords of Lycia. These kings of ours who feed upon the fat sheep appointed and drink the exquisite sweet wine, since indeed there is strength of valour in them, since they fight in the forefront of the Lycians." The revolution which converted Rome from a monarchy into a republic appears to have done little to change the nature of military leadership, for the most prominent figures in the new state were still expected to fight in a conspicuous manner. The heroic ideal was to rush out in front of the other warriors and clash with enemy chieftains, fighting and winning within sight of all. On some occasions, such duels could be formally arranged with the enemy, as when the three Horatii brothers fought as champions against the three Curiatii brothers of neighbouring Alba Longa. According to the legend, two of the Romans were quickly cut down, but not before they had wounded their opponents. The last, Horatius, then pretended to flee, drawing the Curiatii into pursuit until they had separated, at which point he turned round and killed each one separately. Returning to Rome amid the acclamations of the army and the rest of his fellow citizens, the victor then killed his own sister for failing to welcome him enthusiastically enough. She had been betrothed to one of the Curiatii. This was just one story of individual heroics, even if its sequel was brutal and used to illustrate the gradual regulation of the behaviour of the men of violence by the wider community. Another involved Horatius Cocles, the man who held off the entire Etruscan army while the bridge across the Tiber was broken down behind him and then swam to safety. Whether or not there is any truth in such tales, they testify to a type of warfare prevalent in many primitive cultures. A feature of the stories about early Rome was the willingness to accept outsiders into the community, something that was rare elsewhere in the ancient world. Rome steadily grew in size and population, and as it expanded, so too did the scale of its wars. The bands of warriors following individual heroic leaders were replaced by a wider levy of all those who could provide themselves with the necessary equipment to fight. In time, we do not understand this process well in the case of Rome, or indeed any other Greek or Italian city, the Romans started to fight as hoplites in a tightly formed block or phalanx. Hoplites carried a round, bronze-faced shield some 3 feet in diameter, wore a helmet, cuirass, and greaves, and fought primarily with a long, thrusting spear. The hoplite phalanx gave far fewer opportunities for acts of conspicuous heroism, for the densely packed warriors could see little of what was going on beyond a range of a few feet. As a small number of heroes ceased to dominate battles and the issue was instead decided by many hundreds, sometimes thousands, of hoplites fighting shoulder to shoulder, so the political balance of the community changed. Just as kings and chieftains had justified their authority by their prominence in war, so now the hoplite class demanded influence in the state commensurate with their battlefield role. In time, they began annually to elect their own leaders to preside over the state in both peace and war. Most of these men were still drawn from a fairly narrow group of families, descended mainly from the old warrior aristocracy, who did not readily concede power. After a number of experiments with different systems of magistracies, it became established practice to choose by election two consuls to act as the Republic's senior executive officers. The voting took place in an assembly known as the Comitia Centuriata, in which citizens voted in groups determined by their function in the army. The consuls had equal power, or imperium, for the Romans were afraid to allow supreme authority to any individual, but usually each was given an independent field command. By the 4th century BC, few enemies required the attention of Rome's entire military resources under both consuls. It was also an indication of the growing size of the Republic and the increased scale of its wars that in most years war was being fought simultaneously against two enemies. The word legio, legion, had originally meant simply levy and referred to the entire force raised by the Republic in time of war. Probably from the early days of the consulship, it became normal practice to divide the levy into two and so provide each magistrate with a force to command, and over time, legion became the name for the subdivision. Later, the number would increase again, and the internal organization of each legion become more sophisticated. The Roman Republic continued to grow, defeating the Etruscans, Samnites, and most other Italian peoples, before subduing the Greek colonies in Italy by the early 3rd century BC. Yet in many ways Italy was a military backwater, and the Romans, along with other Italian peoples, somewhat primitive in their methods of war-making. In the later 5th century BC, the Peloponnesian War between Athens and Sparta and their allies had swept aside many of the conventions of hoplite warfare. By the 4th century BC, most Greek states were increasingly reliant on small groups of professional soldiers or mercenaries, in place of the traditional phalanx raised, when needed, from all those citizens able to afford hoplite arms. Armies had become more complex, containing different types of infantry and sometimes cavalry as well, while campaigns lasted longer than in the past and more often involved sieges. Such warfare placed more demands on generals than the simple days of two phalanxes ploughing into each other on an open plain, when the commander had simply taken his place in the front rank to inspire his men. Though most of these innovations had appeared first in the Greek states, it was to be the barbarian Macedonian kings to the north who created a far more effective army, where cavalry and infantry fought in support of each other, which marched quickly to surprise its opponents and was capable of taking walled cities when necessary. Philip II and Alexander overran all of Greece, before the latter crossed to Asia and swept eastwards through Persia and into India. Alexander is supposed to have slept with a copy of the Iliad under his pillow, and consciously wanted to associate himself with Homer's greatest hero, Achilles. Before a battle, Alexander took great care to maneuver and deploy his army so that it could advance and apply coordinated pressure all along the enemy's front. Then, at the critical moment, he would lead his companion cavalry in a charge against the most vulnerable part of the opposition's line. In this way, he inspired his soldiers to heights of valor, but once the fighting began, he could exercise little direct influence on the course of the battle. Instead, he trusted his subordinate officers to control the troops in other sectors of the field, although it is notable that he made very little use of reserves, largely because he would have been unable to send the order to commit these troops once the fighting had begun. Alexander was an exceptionally bold leader, paying the price for his command style in a long catalogue of wounds, many received in hand-to-hand combat. Few of the successor generals who tore Alexander's empire apart in the decades after his death were quite as reckless, but even so, most felt obliged at some stage to lead a charge in person. King Pyrrhus of Epirus, who claimed direct descent from Achilles, was one of the keenest to fight hand to hand, and was eventually killed leading his men to storm a city. He was also a thinking soldier, who had produced a manual on generalship, which has unfortunately not survived. In battle, Plutarch claims that although he exposed himself in personal combat and drove back all who encountered him, he kept throughout a complete grasp of the progress of the battle and never lost his presence of mind. He directed the action as though he was watching it from a distance, yet he was everywhere himself, and always managed to be at hand to support his troops wherever the pressure was greatest. Personal heroism was still considered both appropriate and admirable in an army commander, especially when he was a monarch, but he was also expected to direct his army closely. Alexander's greatest victories had been won over enemies far less effective in close combat than his Macedonians, but his successors spent much of their time fighting each other, and so were usually confronted by armies almost identical in equipment, tactics, and doctrine to their own men. With no inbuilt superiority over the enemy, commanders had to seek some special advantage to ensure victory. The military theory which flourished at this period was greatly concerned with the right conditions in which a commander should fight a battle. The Romans first came face to face with a modern Hellenistic army in 280 BC when Pyrrhus came to the aid of the Greek city of Tarentum in southern Italy in its conflict with Rome. After two major defeats, the Romans were finally able to defeat the king of Epirus in 275 at Melventum, but the stubborn resilience of Roman legionaries had more to do with this success than any inspired generalship. In many respects, the Roman style of command belonged to an older, simpler era, with far less expectation of prolonged maneuvering prior to a pitched battle, as each side searched for as many little advantages as possible. Yet, once the fighting started, the behavior of the Roman general differed markedly from his Hellenistic counterpart. A magistrate rather than a king, the Roman had no fixed place on the battlefield, no royal bodyguard at whose head he was expected to charge. The consul stationed himself wherever he thought the most important fighting would occur, and during the battle moved along behind the fighting line, encouraging and directing the troops. Hellenistic armies rarely made much use of reserves, but the basic formation of the Roman legion kept half to two-thirds of its men back from the front line at the start of the battle. It was the general's task to feed in these fresh troops as the situation required. Rome had certainly not abandoned all heroic traditions, and at times generals did engage in combat. Many aristocrats boasted of the number of times they had fought and won single combats, although by the 3rd century BC at the latest, they had most likely done this while serving in a junior capacity. At Centinum in 295 BC, one of the two consuls with the army, an exceptionally large force to face a confederation of Samnite, Etruscan, and Gallic enemies, performed an archaic ritual when he devoted himself as a sacrifice to the earth and the gods of the underworld to save the army of the Roman people. Once he had completed the rites, this man, Publius Decius Mus, spurred his horse forward into a lone charge against the Gauls and was swiftly killed. Livy claims that he had formally handed over his command to a subordinate before this ritual suicide, a gesture which was something of a family tradition, for his father had acted in the same way in 340 BC. Centinum ended in a hard-fought and costly Roman victory. One of the most important attributes of a Roman aristocrat was virtus, for which the modern derivative virtue is a poor translation. Virtus embraced all the important martial qualities, including not just physical courage and skill at arms, but also the moral courage and other gifts of a commander. A Roman nobleman was expected to be capable of deploying an army in battle order and controlling it during the fighting, paying attention to the small detail of individual units and their commitment to the combat. He was to have the confidence and sense to make appropriate decisions, firmly adhering to them or having the courage to confess an error as appropriate. Most of all, he was never to doubt Rome's ultimate victory. Such an ideal permitted a broad range of interpretations. Some men obviously continued to place far greater stress on the aspect of individual heroics, but they were a clear minority by the time of the First Punic War, when we can first begin to glimpse something of the behavior of Rome's commanders in the field. Even those who still aspired to personal deeds of valor did not feel that this absolved them from the direction of their army, for such acts were simply an additional source of glory and did not alter the commander's most important role. The context of command. War and politics were inseparably linked at Rome, and her leaders were expected to guide public life in the forum or lead an army on campaign as required. Since foreign enemies posed a great and obvious threat to the state's prosperity, and at times even its existence, the defeat of an enemy in war was held to be the greatest achievement for any leader and brought the most glory. Since for many centuries senators provided all of the state's senior magistrates and commanders, the capacity to provide successful military leadership became a central part of the senatorial class self-image. Later, even the most unmilitary of emperors, and we should remember that our word emperor is derived from the Latin imperator or general, paraded the successes achieved by their armies and suffered a serious drop in prestige if wars went badly. Until late antiquity, the men who commanded Rome's armies followed a career, the cursus honorum, which brought them a range of civil and military posts. Governors of a province were expected to administrate and dispense justice or wage war, depending upon the situation. However, it is a grave mistake to view the Roman system through modern eyes and to claim that Roman commanders were not really soldiers at all, but politicians, for these men were always both. Military glory helped a man's political career and might in turn lead to further opportunities for command in war. Even men whose talents were more suited either to fighting or politicking had to have at least some minimum proficiency in both if they were to have the chance to show their talents. Successful generals usually profited financially from their campaigns, but the gains in prestige were in some respects even greater. After a victory in the field, a commander's army would formally hail him as imperator. On his return to Rome, he could then expect to be granted the right to celebrate a triumph, when he and his troops would process along the Sacra Via, the sacred way, which led through the heart of the city. The general rode in a four-horse chariot, his face painted red and dressed so that he resembled the old terracotta statues of Jupiter Optimus Maximus. For that day he was treated almost as if he were divine, although a slave stood behind him in the chariot, continually whispering to him to remember that he was mortal. A triumph was a great honour, something which the family would continue to commemorate for generations. Many of Rome's greatest buildings were erected or restored by successful generals using the spoils they had won in war, while the family house would be permanently decorated with the wreathed symbols of a triumph. Only a minority of senators won a triumph, but even this group struggled to prove that their triumph was greater than that of anyone else. Inscriptions recording the achievements of commanders tended to go into great detail and, most of all, sought to quantify success, listing the numbers of enemies killed or enslaved, of cities stormed or warships captured. For a Roman aristocrat, it was always important to win victories bigger and better than other senators. The cursus honorum varied in its form and flexibility over the centuries, but always followed an annual political cycle. By the time of the Second Punic War, it was supposed to begin with either 10 full years or 10 campaigns of military service in the cavalry, on the staff of a family member or friend, or as an officer such as a military tribune. After this, a man might stand for election for the office of quaestor, who had essentially financial responsibilities, but might also act as a consul's second-in-command. Other posts following a year as quaestor, such as tribune of the plebs and aedile, did not have military responsibilities, but by 218 BC, the praetorship sometimes involved a field command. However, the most important campaigns were always allocated to the year's consuls. All of these magistracies were held only for 12 months, and an individual was not supposed to be re-elected to the same office before a 10-year interval had elapsed. Magistrates given a military command possessed imperium, the power to issue orders to soldiers and dispense justice. The more senior the magistracy, the greater the imperium of the individual. Occasionally, the Senate chose to extend the command of a consul or praetor for a year at a time, and their rank was then proconsul or propraetor, respectively. Elections at Rome were fiercely competitive, and many of the 300 or so members of the Senate at any one time had never held any magistracy. The voting system gave disproportionate weight to the wealthier classes in society and tended to favour the members of the oldest and richest of the noble families. A small number of established senatorial families tended to dominate the consulship, with only a small number of other men reaching this post. Yet the Roman political system was not entirely rigid. Though there was always an inner elite of families, the membership of this group altered over the decades as family lines died out or were supplanted by others. It was also always possible for a man whose family had never yet reached high office to gain the consulship. In a book of this nature, it is not possible to describe in detail the development of the Roman army, but equally it is obviously important to provide some indication of the force at the disposal of each general. At the start of our survey, the Roman army was recruited from all male citizens who possessed the property to equip themselves for war. The wealthiest served as cavalrymen, since they were able to provide themselves with horse, armor, and weapons. The core of the army was formed by the heavy infantry, most of whom were drawn from the owners of small holdings of land. The poor provided light infantrymen who needed no armor and might also serve as rowers in the fleet. Each legion consisted of these three elements: 300 cavalrymen, 3,000 heavy infantrymen, and 1,200 light infantry, velites. The heavy infantry were further divided on the basis of age and military experience into three lines. The youngest 1,200 were known as the hastati and fought in the first line. Those in the prime of life were known as the principes and were stationed as a second line, while 600 veterans or triarii were in the rear. Each line was composed of 10 tactical units or maniples, consisting of two administrative units or centuries, each led by a centurion. The centurion of the right-hand century was senior and commanded the entire maniple if both men were present. The maniples of each line were arranged with intervals equal to their frontage between each unit and the next. The gaps were covered by the maniples of the next line, so that the legion's formation resembled a checkerboard, quincunx. On campaign, each Roman legion was supported by a wing or ala of Latin or Italian allies, composed of roughly the same number of infantry but up to three times as many cavalry. A consul was normally given two legions and two ali. The standard formation placed the legions in the center with one ala on either flank, hence these were usually named the right and left ala accordingly. Some of the allied troops, usually one-fifth of the infantry and a third of the cavalry, were detached from the ali to form the extraordinarii, who were placed at the immediate disposal of the army commander. The extraordinarii were often used to lead the column during an advance or act as rearguard during a retreat. Roman soldiers were not professionals, but men who served in the army as a duty to the Republic. The army is often referred to as a militia force, but it is probably better to think of it as a conscript army, for men would often spend several years consecutively with the legions, although no one was supposed to be called upon to serve for more than 16 years. Military service was an interlude to normal life, although one that does not appear to have been generally resented. Once in the army, citizens willingly subjected themselves to a system of discipline that was extremely harsh, losing most of their legal rights until they were discharged. Even minor infractions could be punished very harshly, while serious breaches of discipline were punishable by death. The Roman army remained essentially an impermanent force, the legions being demobilized when the Senate decided that they were no longer needed. Although the soldiers might well be called upon to serve the Republic again, they would not do so in the same units and under the same commanders. Each army and legion raised was unique, and would gradually increase in efficiency as it underwent training. Legions which saw active service were often very well drilled and disciplined, but as soon as these were disbanded, the process would have to begin afresh with new armies. There was therefore an odd mixture of discipline and organization, as strict as many professional armies, with the impermanence of a continuing cycle of recruitment, training, and demobilization before starting again. Finally, it is worth mentioning some of the factors which restricted a general's activity throughout our period. One of the most important was the limit on the speed with which information could be communicated. In all practical respects, this was never faster than the pace of a dispatch rider. Instances are recorded of individuals making very long journeys in a short time, and under the Principate the Imperial Post was created to provide messengers with fresh horses at regular intervals. It was always easier to convey such messages within the empire through settled provinces along well-maintained roads. The network of roads constructed by the Romans assisted such communication and the movement of men and supplies in general, but was only really of value within the provinces. Offensive operations beyond the frontiers were usually conducted over a much simpler network of roads and paths. At times, the Roman army also devised systems of signalling using flags or, more often, beacons, but such devices could only convey the simplest of messages and were anyway most suited to an army in fixed positions, either along a frontier line or occasionally at a siege. The most important consequence of this was that a general in the field had at most periods considerable freedom of action, since it was impractical to direct operations in detail from the centre of power at Rome. It was also extremely difficult to control divisions of an army spread over even fairly modest distances, which encouraged commanders to keep their forces concentrated under most circumstances. The ancient world was a world almost without maps, certainly with few, if any, of sufficient detail and accuracy to assist in the planning of military operations. Commanders could gather information about the landscape from a range of sources. If fighting within a province, the quantity and quality of such information was obviously greatly enhanced. But for most practical purposes, it was a question of sending someone ahead to look. Generals would often carry out reconnaissance in person, in the same way that they would often personally interrogate prisoners or interview merchants or members of the local population to gather news. The comparatively short range of weaponry, which was still essentially a reflection of human muscle power, was extremely limited, and this, combined with the size of armies, ensured that a general could be in a position to see all of his own and the enemy army during a battle. Visibility was only limited by terrain, weather, and the capacity of the human eye without the benefit of even such simple optical enhancements as the telescope. Roman commanders were therefore able to direct operations at a much more immediate and personal level than has been the case in more recent warfare. On campaign and during battle and siege, Roman generals were highly active, spending a lot of their time close to the enemy at risk of injury or death from missiles or sudden attackers. Although no longer leaders in the heroic mold of Alexander, they were in some ways closer to their men, sharing the hardships of campaign in a way that would be praised as characteristically Roman. Whatever the political and social reality, the ideal persisted of the general as a fellow citizen and fellow soldier, comiles, who shared in a common enterprise with the rest of the army. Chapter 1. The Shield and Sword of Rome, Fabius and Marcellus. Quintius Fabius Maximus, approximately 275 to 203 BC, and Marcus Claudius Marcellus, 271 to 208 BC. Fabius Maximus, when opposed by Hannibal, decided to avoid taking any dangerous risks and concern himself only with the defence of Italy, and in this way earned himself the nickname the Delayer and a great reputation as a general. In November 218 BC, Hannibal crossed the Alps and burst into northern Italy. The Romans were astounded by the boldness and suddenness of this attack, so unlike the cautious strategy pursued by Carthage in the First Punic War. The Second War was sparked by Hannibal's attack on Saguntum, a Spanish city allied to Rome, and it was in Spain that the Roman Senate had expected to confront the Carthaginian general. Of the two consuls for 218, one was to take an army to Spain, whilst his colleague went to Sicily to prepare for an invasion of North Africa which would threaten Carthage itself. The strategy was aggressive, direct, and characteristically Roman, but began to unravel almost immediately. Scipio, the consul travelling to Spain, stopped at Massilia, Marseille, and discovered that Hannibal and a large army had recently passed by on its way eastwards. Completely wrong-footed, the Romans struggled to react to the new situation. Yet, for a succession of commanders, Hannibal's invasion seemed like a marvelous opportunity to win themselves glory by defeating this great enemy. Each displayed great enthusiasm to close with the Carthaginian army and fight it anywhere and under any conditions. Scipio hurried back to take command of the legions already in the Po Valley, campaigning against the Gallic tribes of the region. With his cavalry and light infantry, he hastened to make contact with Hannibal, only to be brushed aside with disdainful ease by the numerically superior and more skillful Punic horse near the river Ticinus. In December, his recently arrived colleague, Sempronius Longus, eagerly gave battle with their combined armies at Trebia, and was utterly defeated, suffering very heavy losses. The following June, Flaminius, one of the consuls of 217, following the enemy too closely in an effort to bring them to battle, before he was joined by his fellow consul, was ambushed and killed along with 15,000 of his men. Roman losses in these early operations were appalling and made all the worse because they came in defeats suffered on Italian soil. The enemy appeared unstoppable, and in some later sources, Hannibal assumes the elemental power of a force of nature, smashing everything in his path. In truth, the Romans were utterly outclassed at this stage of their war. Hannibal was unquestionably one of the ablest commanders of antiquity, and commanded an army in every respect superior to the inexperienced legions facing it. It was not really an army of Carthaginians, who provided only its senior officers, but was a mixture of many races, Numidians and Libyans from Africa, Iberians, Celtiberians, and Lusitanians from Spain, and in time, Gauls, Ligurians, and Italians. At its heart were the troops who had campaigned in Spain for many years under the leadership of Hannibal's family, all of them experienced, confident, and highly disciplined. In comparison to this sophisticated fighting force, the legions maneuvered clumsily and trusted more to individual courage and stubbornness than superior tactics to win the day. The ferocity of Hannibal's onslaught shocked Rome and pushed her to the very brink of utter defeat. Yet, somehow, the Romans endured disaster after catastrophic disaster, any of which would have been enough to force other contemporary states to capitulate, and in the end went on to win the war. The scale of the achievement was recognized even at the time, and highlighted afterwards when it appeared to inaugurate Rome's rapid rise to dominate the Mediterranean world. Later, in the mid-2nd century BC, Polybius, who hoped to explain this sudden rise to a Greek audience, would begin the detailed narrative of his universal history with the Second Punic War. He and later writers were greatly aided in their task because the conflict had inspired the Romans themselves to begin writing prose history. The first, by Fabius Pictor, was in Greek, but in the early 2nd century, Cato the Elder produced his Origines in Latin. Both men had participated in the war with Hannibal and dealt with the conflict in detail, and although their works have survived only in fragments, it is at this period that we at last begin to have fuller, more reliable sources for examining the campaigns of Roman commanders. The two subjects of this chapter were exceptional in many ways. Both enjoyed long periods of continuous command, something which would be rare until the late Republic. Each had also won high office and military distinction before the Second Punic War, and indeed had grown to manhood and served with distinction during the First Punic War. In 218, Fabius and Marcellus were in their late 50s, rather elderly by Roman standards for a field command. Yet for much of the war they were to lead armies against Hannibal, and if neither was ever able to inflict a decisive defeat upon the Carthaginian, they were able to avoid suffering a similar blow at his hands, which in itself was no mean achievement. Their victories were often small-scale and nearly always won over Hannibal's allies, gradually weakening his power. Cunctator, the Delayer, the dictatorship of Fabius Maximus, 217 BC. "We have been defeated in a great battle," was the staid, unemotional announcement made in the Forum when news reached Rome of the destruction of Flaminius and his army at Lake Trasimene. In spite of the calm front presented by the urban praetor Marcus Pomponius, Livy tells us that panic and despair began to spread, especially when a few days later the news arrived that a force of 4,000 horsemen, sent by his consular colleague to join Flaminius, had been surrounded and all killed or captured by the enemy. With one army effectively destroyed, the other some distance away and crippled by the loss of its cavalry, there seemed nothing to stop Hannibal from moving directly against the city itself. At this time of crisis, the Senate decided to appoint a military dictator, a single magistrate with supreme imperium. This was a rarely used expedient, for it violated the basic principle of Roman politics that no one man should hold overwhelming power, and had not been employed for over 30 years. Normally a dictator was nominated by one of the consuls, but since Flaminius was dead and his colleague unable or unwilling to reach Rome, it was decided to select the man by election. Technically, this may have meant that the appointee's title was actually pro dictator, but whether or not this was so, his powers were identical to those of any other dictator. The man chosen by the vote of the Comitia Centuriata, the assembly of the Roman people organized into groups according to their role in the archaic army, was Quintus Fabius Maximus. Fabius was 58, a member of one of the patrician clans which had formed Rome's oldest aristocracy. Now they shared their dominant position with a number of wealthy and well-established plebeian families, but continued to enjoy distinguished careers. Fabius had already held two consulships in 233 and 228, and the censorship in 230. The name Maximus had been earned by the military achievements of his great-grandfather, Quintus Fabius Rullianus, consul 322 and dictator in 315, fighting against the Samnites. The family adopted the name permanently, for the senatorial aristocracy missed no opportunity of publicly celebrating the great deeds of their ancestors, and so promoting the electoral success of current and future generations. It was an equally Roman characteristic to give individual senators nicknames, often based on their appearance. In part, this was to assist in distinguishing the different members of a family with similar or identical names, but it probably had more to do with the Roman's rather blunt sense of humour. Thanks to a prominent wart on his lip, the young Quintus Fabius Maximus was dubbed Verrucosus, spotty. Later accounts describe him as a stolid, cautious child, whose abilities were not at first obvious. Through constant practice as a young adult, he became a capable officer and a skilled public speaker, emphasizing the twin dominance of war and politics in the public life of Rome. There is little detailed information about Fabius' career before the Second Punic War. During his first consulship, he campaigned against the Ligurians, a loosely organized and fiercely independent mountain people of northern Italy. It seems probable that the war was fought in response to raiding against Roman and allied lands in northern Etruria. Fabius attacked the tribes, defeating them in battle and halting, at least temporarily, their plundering forays. For this success, he was awarded a triumph. This experience of campaigning in difficult terrain against an enemy skilled in ambush may well have instilled in Fabius a strong sense of the importance of keeping an army under tight control, and only fighting at a time and manner of his own choosing. These were certainly to be the keynotes of his generalship throughout the war with Hannibal. As dictator, Fabius Maximus' first task was to restore some semblance of confidence and normality to Rome itself. Defenses were prepared in case Hannibal should mount a direct attack. Two new legions were raised and organized, and considerable care was taken to ensure that the Roman field army would be properly supplied. Yet, more than anything else, the dictator at first devoted his efforts to religious matters. Flaminius' defeat was publicly blamed on his failure to perform the proper rites before embarking on his campaign. The Sibylline books, a collection of ancient prophecies, were consulted to ensure that appropriate ceremonies were undertaken and suitable dedications made to regain the god's favor. As a Greek, Polybius found many aspects of Roman religion absurdly superstitious, and believed that many senators cynically viewed such things as a means of controlling the emotions of the ignorant and uneducated poor. Whilst such views were certainly held by men like Caesar and Cicero in the late Republic, it is not necessarily the case that Fabius and all of his contemporaries shared them. When the Senate spent time discussing such issues, it emphasized that public affairs of all types were now to be conducted in a correct and thorough way. From the beginning, Fabius made it clear that he expected to be treated in a manner appropriate to the full dignity of his office. He was accompanied by 24 attendants, or lictors, who carried the fasces, bundles of rods tied around an axe, which symbolized a magistrate's power to dispense corporal and capital punishment. The imperium of other magistrates lapsed, or more accurately became subordinate, when a dictator was appointed. As he went to rendezvous with the surviving consul, Fabius sent a messenger ahead instructing the man to dismiss his own lictors before coming into the dictator's presence. Having linked up with the consul and taken over command of his army, Fabius had a force of 4 legions under his command, and almost certainly the 4 allied ali which would normally support them. Our sources provide no information about actual numbers, but at normal strength such a force would muster between 30,000 and 40,000 men. This was a strong army by Roman standards, but it was of highly doubtful quality. The consul's army was based around survivors of the defeat at Trebia, so that although they had been in service for more than a year, their experience was mainly of defeat. These legions and ali also lacked all or most of their cavalry, which had been destroyed in the aftermath of Trasimene. The rest of the army had only been under arms for a matter of weeks and were not yet familiar with each other and their officers. Nor was there much time or opportunity to integrate the 2 elements of the army into a single body used to operating together. Therefore, however impressive Fabius' field army may have appeared, it was in no respect a match for Hannibal's veteran troops. It was probably also significantly outnumbered by the enemy, and especially at a disadvantage in both the quality and quantity of its cavalry. It is in this context that we must see the campaign waged by the dictator. As a magistrate with supreme power, a dictator did not have a colleague but a deputy, entitled the Master of Horse, Magister Equitum. The title seems to date back to Rome's early history, when the strength of the army consisted of the hoplite phalanx, so that the dictator led the heavy infantry, whilst his subordinate took the cavalry. Law forbade the dictator even to ride a horse on campaign, but Fabius had requested and been granted an exemption to this before leaving Rome. It was impossible for a man on foot to exercise effective command and control over an army of 4 legions, and in this case, practicality overrode archaic tradition. Normally, a dictator chose his master of horse, but in the unusual circumstances of Fabius' election, it had been decided to allow the voters also to choose his subordinate. The ballot came out in favor of Marcus Minucius Rufus, who had held the consulship in 221. The 2 men do not appear to have got along well, and Minucius was to display a boldness similar to Scipio, Sempronius, and Flaminius. Hannibal had moved east after Trasimene, crossing the Apennines into Picenum and the rich plains down to the Adriatic shore. Much of his army was in poor health, the men suffering from scurvy and the horses from mange, for the intensive campaigning had denied them sufficient rest to recover from the exertions of the epic march to reach Italy. The lull in the campaign did much to restore the army's fitness, but we cannot be sure how long it lasted. Later in the summer, Fabius closed to camp within 6 miles of Hannibal near the town of Aeque, or Arpi, according to Livy. The Carthaginian immediately sought a decisive encounter and marched his men out to form up for battle and challenge the Romans to fight. The Roman army remained in camp and, after some hours, Hannibal withdrew, assuring his men that this demonstrated that the Romans were afraid of them. Further attempts to provoke Fabius to battle or to ambush his army failed, for the dictator remained determined to avoid contact. After several days, Hannibal marched away, his soldiers devastating the land as they passed through it. That they were able to do this, often literally under the watching gaze of the dictator's army, was an enormous blow to Roman pride. The legions were recruited overwhelmingly from farmers, and it was especially depressing for such men to know that they could not prevent an enemy from marauding through the fields of their kindred and allies. Yet always Fabius shadowed the enemy, staying 1 or 2 days' march behind the Punic army and refusing to close. He moved carefully, keeping his army together under close discipline, and exploiting their local knowledge of the landscape to move from one favourable position to the next. Whenever possible, he kept to high ground, avoiding open plains where the enemy's superior cavalry posed a great danger. Hannibal was never willing to attack Fabius' army when the Romans had the advantage of position. The care taken before the campaign to gather adequate transport materials and supplies of food to support the large Roman army now paid dividends, for it permitted Fabius to move as he wanted rather than continually having to shift position to gather more food and fodder. When foraging parties did have to go out, they were always covered by a strong force formed of cavalry and light infantry to guard against ambush. In the small-scale skirmishing between patrols and outposts of the two armies, it was generally the Romans who had the advantage. Livy and Plutarch both claimed that from the beginning, Hannibal was secretly disturbed by Fabius' refusal to be drawn into battle. Certainly, by the standards of contemporary military theory, the dictator was doing the right thing. Much of this literature concerned itself with the circumstances under which a commander should fight a pitched battle. This was to be risked only when the prospects of success were good, and after a general had gained every possible advantage, however minor, for his men. Following the defeats at Trebia and Trasimene, the confidence of Hannibal's troops was extremely high. Outnumbered and inexperienced, the dictator's army would almost certainly have suffered defeat in any massed encounter fought on even terms. In these circumstances, Fabius, like the good commander of the military manuals, avoided battle and sought ways to change the odds in his favour. The experience of active campaigning gradually improved the efficiency of the Roman army. The small victories won in skirmishes helped to boost morale, and very, very slowly began to wear down the enemy. It would take a long time to recover from the early defeats and build an army capable of confronting Hannibal without enjoying overwhelming advantages of position, but Fabius started the process. The dictator's strategy made perfect sense by the standards of contemporary military theory, although we cannot know whether Fabius was aware of this or was simply acting in a way he considered to be appropriate to the situation. Rome still had an essentially impermanent militia army, rather than the professional forces fielded by other large states. Knowledge of military theory does not yet appear to have been widespread amongst the senators who provided the army commanders, and as a result, Roman methods of making war often lacked subtlety, relying instead on aggression and brute force. These attitudes had characterized Ticinus, Trebia, and Trasimene, but even these defeats do not appear to have done much to dampen the Roman elite's instinctive urge to attack the enemy as soon as possible. Fabius' cautious shadowing of the Punic army was deeply unpopular with the army, and especially its senior officers, most notably the Master of Horse. As the campaign progressed, his opposition to the strategy became increasingly vocal. Fabius was nicknamed Hannibal's Paedagogus, after the slave who accompanied a Roman schoolboy carrying his books and other paraphernalia. Hannibal, having drifted steadily westwards, then drove into Campania and plundered the Ager Falernus, Falernian plain, a fertile area whose wine would later win the praise of the poet Horace. Marauding through this area, he hoped either to spur the Romans into risking a battle or to demonstrate to Rome's allies that she was no longer strong enough to protect them. It is possible that the Carthaginian already had hopes of persuading the Campanians to defect. In spite of the urgings of Minucius and his other officers, Fabius kept to the high ground which surrounds the Campanian plain, observing the enemy and refusing to be drawn. However, Livy tells us that one patrol, consisting of 400 allied cavalry led by Lucius Hostilius Mancinus, disobeyed orders and were nearly all killed or captured in the ensuing skirmish. Fabius felt that at last the enemy had made a mistake. He guessed that Hannibal would withdraw by the same pass that he had used to enter the plain and managed to occupy the place before the enemy. Late in the day, a detachment of 4,000 men set up camp in the pass itself, whilst the main army camped on a hill overlooking it. It was a very strong position, and Fabius hoped that, should the enemy try to force the pass, he would be able to inflict considerable losses upon them, and at the very least prevent them from carrying off the great quantity of plunder which they had gathered during their raiding. Hannibal's army was cut off from its original base in Spain and from its allies in Cisalpine Gaul, and, lacking a port, was not in effective communication with Carthage. Even a minor defeat could seriously damage him, shattering the impression of invincibility created by his early victories and discouraging any of Rome's allies from defecting. The rival armies were camped some 2 miles apart. Livy claims that Hannibal launched a direct attack on the pass but was repulsed, although the more reliable Polybius does not mention this. All of our sources are agreed on what happened next, for it became one of the classic ploys or stratagems of the ancient world. Hannibal instructed Hasdrubal, the officer responsible for overseeing the army's supply train, amongst other things, to gather a great quantity of dry wood. These faggots were then tied to the horns of 2,000 plough oxen taken from the great herd of captured cattle. During the night, servants were ordered to light these torches and then drive the cattle up through the pass. With them went his experienced light infantrymen, who were tasked with keeping the herd together. In the meantime, the remainder of the army, who had earlier been given specific orders to eat and rest, formed up into a march column headed by the best of the close order infantry, most probably the Libyans. The Roman force in the pass, mistaking the fires for the main column, came down the slope to attack, but the confused skirmish was broken up when many of the panicking cattle stampeded through the middle. With the pass now open, the Carthaginian army was able to march through unopposed. Fabius and the main Roman force did nothing, waiting in camp for daylight. It was unclear from the mass of torches and the noise of fighting precisely what was going on, and the dictator utterly refused to risk battle without a clear knowledge of the situation, in case he was lured into a trap. Fighting at night was rare in the ancient world, especially for large armies, as it was very difficult for leaders to control their men, and easy for troops to get lost or fall into confusion and panic. It is probable that Fabius realized that his own army was likely to be at a great disadvantage in such circumstances when faced with Hannibal's better trained and more experienced soldiers. By the time the sun rose on the next day, Hannibal's main force, along with the bulk of its baggage train, was through the pass. The Carthaginian was even able to send back a force of Spanish foot to extricate the light infantrymen, killing around 1,000 Romans in the process. The escape of the Carthaginian army reflected once again its high quality and the genius of its commander, but it was a major humiliation for Fabius. It was now near the end of the summer, and Hannibal began to look for a suitable place to take up winter quarters. The Roman army followed him as he went east again, but Fabius was required in Rome to oversee some religious rites, and for a while the army came under the command of Minucius. Hannibal stormed and sacked the town of Gerunium in Luceria, and then began to send out large detachments of men to gather provisions, intending to find sufficient supplies to maintain the army throughout the winter. Whilst much of his army was dispersed in this way, and its commander disinclined to fight a serious action as a result, the master of horse attacked and won a large-scale skirmish outside the town. Exaggerated reports of this action were brought to a Rome starved of any good news for the last 2 years. In a wave of popular enthusiasm, which was allegedly opposed by all but one of the Senate, Minucius was granted equal power to the dictator, effectively a return to the normal situation of having two consuls of equal authority rather than a single supreme magistrate. On his return, Fabius and Minucius divided the army into two equal parts and camped separately, the dictator having apparently refused a suggestion that they hold command of the whole force on alternate days. A short while afterwards, Minucius was lured into an ambush by Hannibal. Only the arrival of Fabius' men to cover their retreat prevented the defeat from degenerating into yet another disaster. The master of horse led his men into Fabius' camp, and there greeted the dictator not simply as commander, but as father. It was a very emotive gesture by Roman standards, for fathers possessed massive powers over their children, and it was almost inconceivable for a son to oppose his father politically. This brief experiment with two commanders being abandoned, the remainder of the campaigning season passed without major fighting. At the end of his sixth month of office, Fabius laid down the dictatorship and returned to Rome. He had granted the Romans a breathing space to recover and rebuild their forces. In the next year, one of the largest armies ever fielded by the Republic would serve under the command of the consuls. In the event, it marched to an even greater disaster than any which had preceded it. A hero of the old school, Marcus Claudius Marcellus. On the 2nd of August 216 BC, almost 50,000 Roman and allied soldiers were slaughtered on the narrow plain north of the little ruined town of Cannae. Fabius' efforts had been wasted, but the defeat was not inevitable and certainly not anticipated by the Romans. Nor should we automatically accept the later tradition of Livy and others who declared that the former dictator had wanted the consuls of 216 to pursue his own strategy of avoiding battle. Once again, in a time of crisis, the Romans appointed a military dictator, Marcus Junius Pera, who began the slow process of rebuilding Rome's strength. Hannibal did not march against Rome after Cannae, something which the Romans never quite understood, and although there were moments of panic, his failure to do so allowed them time to recover mentally and revert to their normal belief that a war could only ever end in eventual victory. Yet the situation was still extremely bleak, for much of southern Italy had defected to the Carthaginians by the end of the year. The consuls elected for 215 were Lucius Postumius Albinus and Tiberius Sempronius Gracchus. However, a few months after Cannae, the former was ambushed and killed along with most of his army in Cisalpine Gaul in another dreadful blow to Roman confidence. The man elected to replace him was Marcus Claudius Marcellus, but when he took up office on the 15th of March, bad omens were held to have declared the vote invalid. Fabius Maximus may well have been behind this, for after a rapidly held election he received the vacant magistracy. Part of the objection may have been that both Marcellus and Gracchus were plebeians, when it was normal for one of the two consuls each year to be a patrician. Yet it really is very difficult to understand precisely what was going on behind the scenes. One of the most striking things about the Second Punic War is the degree to which normal politics went on at Rome, even at times of appalling crisis, as senators scrambled for the opportunity to play a distinguished role in the fighting. It is possible that Fabius felt that Marcellus was too aggressive a general for the current circumstances, but since he anyway received a field command as proconsul, this seems unlikely. When Fabius presided over the elections for the next year, he demanded that the people think again when two inexperienced men began to head the polls. In the event, he was re-elected with Marcellus as his colleague, although to what extent this was a matter of choice is impossible to know. Marcellus was 57 in 214 BC, and had already been consul in 222 and praetor in 224 and 216. As a youth, he had fought in Sicily during the First Punic War, winning many decorations, as well as a reputation for individual acts of heroism. Amongst these honours was at least one civic crown, Corona Civica, Rome's highest decoration, presented by one citizen to another as an admission that the recipient had saved his life. This was given to him by his brother Ottacilius. In many ways, Marcellus resembled Achilles, Hector and the other aristocratic warriors of Homer's Iliad or Rome's early heroes, in his boldness, aggression, and the relish he took in single combat. It was an old-fashioned style of fighting, associated more with tribal warbands than regular armies, but continued to characterize his approach to warfare even when he reached high command. In 222, he and his consular colleague Gnaeus Cornelius Scipio launched a joint invasion of the territory of the Insubres in Cisalpine Gaul. The tribe had suffered a serious defeat at the hands of Flaminius in the previous year, but Marcellus and Scipio were so eager to fight a campaign that they had persuaded the Senate to turn away some Gallic envoys intent on negotiating a surrender. The consuls advanced and besieged the hilltop town oppidum of Acherae. In response, the Insubres, along with allied or mercenary warriors from north of the Alps known as Gaesatae, surrounded Clastidium, a village allied to Rome. Leaving Scipio with the main force, Marcellus took 2/3 of their combined cavalry and 600 light infantrymen to meet the new threat. What then occurred could have come straight out of Homer, and was taken as a subject by the poet Naevius, though our account comes from a later source. When the Romans approached Clastidium, the Gauls came out to meet them, led by a certain King Britomarus. Our sources claim that there were 10,000 of them, but this may well be an exaggeration. The horsemen in a Gallic army, as in the legions at this time, consisted of the wealthier, more aristocratic members of the tribe, able to afford a horse and suitable equipment. Gallic cavalry were in general well mounted. The Romans were later to copy many aspects of horse harness and training from the Gauls, and extremely brave, if unsophisticated tactically. Such men had to justify their honoured position in society by conspicuous displays of courage in war. With Britomarus at their head, standing out, as was proper for a king, in his lavishly gilded and silvered cuirass, the tribal horsemen rushed to engage the outnumbered Romans. Marcellus was equally keen to engage, but Plutarch tells us that during the advance his horse shied and began to turn away. Thinking quickly, the consul pretended that he had deliberately turned his mount to pray to the sun, so that his men would not be discouraged. Putting a positive slant on what appeared to be a bad omen in such a way was another of the attributes of the good general of military theory. Marcellus is supposed to have vowed to dedicate the most impressive panoply amongst the enemy to Jupiter Feretrius, if the god would grant Rome victory. Then, deciding that Britomarus himself wore the finest equipment, the Roman consul spurred ahead of his men to reach the king. The two leaders met between the rival lines. Marcellus drove his spear into the Gaul's body, knocking him from his horse, and then finished him off with a second and a third blow before dismounting to strip the corpse. If Plutarch is to be believed, the two sides did not close whilst this was going on. Then the Roman horse charged home, and after a hard fight, defeated the Gauls. By the time Marcellus rejoined Scipio, Acherae had fallen, and the Romans had moved against Mediolanum, modern Milan, the greatest town of the Insubres, which eventually fell after some hard fighting. On his return to Rome, Marcellus crowned his triumph by dedicating the Spolia Opima in the temple of Jupiter Feretrius on the Capitol. He was only the third man in Rome's history to be awarded this honour, granted to a general who had killed the enemy leader in single combat before a battle. Romulus was supposed to have been the first, and established the tradition that the commander performing this rite should carry the spoils of the defeated enemy suspended from an oak branch. In spite of his age, Marcellus held an almost unbroken series of field commands from the very beginning of the Second Punic War. He was the first Roman commander to come into contact with the main Carthaginian army in the months after Cannae. The actions he fought in late 216 and 215 outside the town of Nola were probably very small in scale, little more than large skirmishes, but they came at a time when Rome was desperate for the slightest military success. This region is very rugged, with few open areas large enough to permit armies to deploy into formal battle lines. Livy's account of the fighting is dramatic, but even he doubted that the casualties in some of these engagements were as heavy as some of his sources claimed. Marcellus led his troops in his usual aggressive manner, but his willingness to attack the enemy should not hide the care he took to do so in the most favourable circumstances possible. Hannibal was unable to outwit and surprise him, as he had so easily baffled other Roman commanders. In this sense, the cautious Fabius and bold Marcellus command styles were very similar, for both men kept their armies under tight control. On the march, the men were not allowed to stray from their units, and the column moved behind a screen of outposts along a route which had already been carefully reconnoitred by patrols, sometimes led by the commander himself. The sites for temporary camps were chosen with care, and engagements begun only when the general chose to fight. Such precautions may appear obvious, almost trivial, but had in the past been frequently ignored by Roman armies. The willingness of Roman citizens to serve in organized units under strict military law should not blind us to the essentially impermanent nature of the legions. The clumsiness with which Roman armies maneuvered in the initial campaigns of the war was typical for this period, as was the frequency with which they were ambushed or collided unexpectedly with an enemy column. Prolonged service, especially successful campaigning, steadily increased a Roman army's military efficiency, but it took a considerable time to achieve basic competence and years for them to reach similar standards to professional troops. Their considerable past experience of campaigning, combined with natural ability, set Marcellus and Fabius apart from the majority of contemporary Roman commanders and made their style of command much closer to the Hellenistic ideal. As far as we can tell, the two men were able to cooperate effectively whenever this was necessary. It should be noted that Fabius' reluctance to confront Hannibal in battle was not extended to smaller detachments of the Punic army, and, most especially, to the Italian communities who had defected to the enemy. Fabius continued to avoid battle with an army which he did not believe he had the capability to defeat, but consistently attacked that enemy indirectly, hoping gradually to weaken him. Both Fabius and Marcellus also took great care to preserve the loyalty of Rome's allies, especially when these appeared to be wavering. A similar story is told about both men winning over a distinguished allied soldier who, discontented by what he felt was a lack of recognition of his services, was planning to defect. In 214, the two consuls combined to recapture the town of Casilinum, captured by Hannibal in the previous year. The siege at first went badly, and Livy claims that it was Marcellus' determination to persevere that prevented a Roman withdrawal, but there is no hint of a major rift between the two men. Both consistently displayed the ideal behaviour of the Roman aristocrat by refusing ever to contemplate the possibility that Rome could lose the war. Hannibal is said to have been exasperated by the enthusiasm with which Marcellus could renew an action, even when he had suffered a reverse on the previous day. The lost account of the Greek philosopher Posidonius reported that, because of their differing approaches to war, Marcellus and Fabius were dubbed the sword and shield of Rome. Whatever their differences of temperament and perhaps of political ambitions, this does highlight their essentially complementary and cooperative relationship when it came to fighting the Carthaginians. Marcellus' greatest achievement of the Second Punic War was the capture of Syracuse in Sicily after a long siege. An early attempt at direct assault having failed, due in part at least to the array of ingenious siege engines used by the defenders and designed by the geometrician Archimedes, who was a native of Syracuse, the Romans resorted to blockade. In the end, a surprise attack allowed the Romans to take the outer ring of fortifications in 212, and during the next year the remainder of the city was captured, betrayed to the Romans, or surrendered. Rivals in the Senate, claiming that the Sicilian campaign was incomplete, managed to deny him a triumph for this achievement, and Marcellus instead celebrated an ovation, riding on horseback instead of in a chariot as he led the procession. The spoils brought back from Syracuse included great quantities of Hellenistic art, up until that point a rarity at Rome. In 209, during his fifth consulship and his last field command, Fabius Maximus recaptured the city of Tarentum through a similar mixture of stealth and treachery on the part of some of the garrison. Marcellus held a fourth consulship in 210, during which he seems to have won a marginal victory over Hannibal at Numistro, and a fifth term in 208. Moving once again into close contact with the Carthaginian in the hope of forcing a battle, he and his consular colleague personally led 220 cavalry to reconnoitre a hill between the two camps. The patrol rode into a trap, for Hannibal had deliberately concealed men on the high ground, suspecting that the Romans would try to occupy it. Marcellus died fighting hand to hand. The other consul and Marcellus' son escaped, though both were wounded, the former mortally. The loss of both consuls was a dreadful blow to Roman pride, But whilst Marcellus was at long last outwitted by the Punic general, he had not led his entire army to defeat and destruction. Polybius, who believed that it was not a deliberate ambush, but a chance encounter with Numidian foragers, was highly critical of a general who risked his own life by leading such a patrol. Yet, as we shall see, many Roman commanders chose to take this chance for the sake of gaining a personal view of an important position. It was the generation of men who reached maturity during the First Punic War, men like Fabius and Marcellus, who managed to steer Rome through the crisis of the Second War. Yet, in the last years of this conflict, it was a younger generation who would actually win the Roman victory. These were men like Caius Claudius Nero, who contributed more than anyone else to the defeat of Hannibal's brother Hasdrubal and a new invading army at Metaurus in 207. The greatest of these new commanders, and also the youngest, was Publius Cornelius Scipio. Chapter 2. A Roman Hannibal, Scipio Africanus. Publius Cornelius Scipio Africanus, approximately 236 to 184 BC. My mother bore a general, imperator, not a warrior, bellator. One of the most striking aspects of the Second Punic War was the willingness of the Roman Senate to dispatch armies to fight in several theatres simultaneously, and the persistence with which these campaigns were prosecuted, even when Hannibal was on the loose in Italy and the issue of the war very much in doubt. Over time, the efforts of Fabius, Marcellus, and others in Italy denied the Carthaginians victory, but the sum of their achievements was still essentially to prevent Rome from losing the conflict. Campaigns in Spain, Sicily, and Macedonia prevented more than a trickle of reinforcements and supplies from reaching Hannibal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.